Welcome you all to the second video. Today I am going to explain regarding the Rankine vapor power cycle. Many of the impracticalities associated with the Carnot vapor power cycle can be eliminated by superheating the steam in the boiler and condensing completely in the condenser. The cycle that results is called as the Rankine cycle. So this is the ideal cycle for the all vapor power plants, whether it is a nuclear power plant, thermal coal power plant, or byproduct gas power plant, or the diesel power plant, whatever it may be. This is the ideal cycle for the all vapor power plants. The ideal Rankine cycle does not involve any internal irreversibilities. That means all the four processes are reversible processes and consist the four processes. One is isentropic compression takes place in the pump, that is 1-2 process. So here we are fixing the state point. One is entry point of the pump and two is exit of the pump, and two to three second process, constant pressure heat addition process in boiler. Whereas in case of Carnot vapor power cycle, second process is isothermal heat addition, correct? But here it is not isothermal heat addition, it is constant pressure heat addition process. And third one is isentropic expansion in turbine. It is same as the Carnot vapor power cycle. And the last process is constant pressure heat rejection in condenser. So this is the simple Rankine power cycle. It is consisting of pump, boiler, turbine, condenser. So this is our state point 1. So we can fix state point 1 anywhere, but here we start from the pump. So this is state point 1, state point 2, exit of the pump. It is same as inlet of the boiler. State point 3 is here, exit of the boiler is same as inlet of the turbine. This is the state point 4. Exit of the turbine or inlet of the condenser, and state point 1 is inlet of the pump or exit of the condenser. So this boiler, strictly speaking, it is consisting of three components. One is economizer, and second one is evaporator, and third one is superheater. So economizer is going to do, it is going to heat the subcooled water into saturated liquid. In evaporator, it is going to convert liquid, saturated liquid, into saturated vapor. And in the superheater, it is going to convert dry saturated steam into saturated steam into superheated steam. So hence in the boiler, it is consisting of three individual components, and this is the steam turbine and this is the condenser. So now let us see the TS diagram. So this is the TS diagram, you can see. So this is the vapor dome. So this is from here to here is saturated liquid line, and from here to here is a saturated vapor line, and this is our critical point. So this is the first process from state point 1 to 2. Isentropic compression takes place in the pump, and 2 to 3 is constant pressure heat addition process. This is a constant pressure line from here to here, okay? So this is constant pressure heat addition process takes place. So here heat energy is enters into the cycle. And 3 to 4 is isentropic expansion process that takes place in turbine, where work is going to produce. Turbine work is going to produce, it is work output. And 4 to 1 is constant pressure heat rejection process, where we are going to reject the heat energy Q out. So for first process, we are going to send the work input. So this is the work input. These are the processes. Water enters the pump at state point 1 as a saturated liquid and is compressed isentropically to the operating pressure of the boiler. So this is what happens in the first process. So water enters here as a saturated liquid and it is going to compress to the high pressure, that is the boiler pressure. The water temperature slightly increases, so due to because of isentropic compression, slight decrease in specific volume of water is happens here. So due to this, the temperature is going to increase. Actually, water is incompressible, it is not going to compress, but due to the high compression, so slightly volume is going to decrease, as a result temperature is going to increase. So that is what I explained here. Water enters the boiler as a compressed liquid at state point 2 here and leaves the superheated vapor at state point 3 and leaving here from the boiler as a superheated vapor. The boiler is basically a large heat exchanger where the heat originating from combustion gases, nuclear reactor or other sources is transferred to the water essentially at constant pressure. So here in the boiler, so either by burning of the coal or by burning of the fuel or any fossil fuels, or here heat energy can be transferred through the nuclear reactor also by the nuclear fusion process or by any other processes, we are transferring heat energy into the water. And also this boiler is consisting of the superheater. It is going to increase the temperature of the dry saturated steam. It is also called as a steam generator. The superheated vapor at state point 3 enters the turbine where it expands isentropically and produces work by rotating the shaft which is connected to the electric generator. So here, as high temperature, high pressure steam enters to the turbine, it is going to expand here and it becomes low pressure and low temperature. So it is going to produce some positive work. The pressure and temperature generally is going to drop in the steam turbine as the steam moves. At state point 4, you can see here. So as a result of pressure and temperature drop, so here the superheated steam becomes wet steam here. But the quality is still is having high quality. Even wet steam also, it is having the quality is around more than 0.9. But in case of Carnot vapor power cycle, the exit quality of the steam is too wet. But here that problem is going to eliminate here. So due to because of steam is entering the turbine as a superheated steam. But in case of Carnot vapor power cycle, here entry of the steam is dry steam only. But here superheated steam enters, as a result, so exit quality of the steam is not too much wet. It is having high quality. And then steam is condensed in a constant pressure in a condenser, which is basically a large heat exchanger, by rejecting heat to a cooling medium such as a lake, river or cooling tower also. By using the cooling tower, we are going to condense the steam. So generally we are going to use the coolant in the condenser to cool the steam. Steam leaves the condenser as saturated liquid and enters the pump, and thus it completes the cycle. So here at the outlet of the condenser, steam is converted into saturated liquid and then it is pumped back and it is sent into the pump. Now let us derive the efficiency equation. This is the steam power plant. So all the individual components here, pump, boiler, turbine and condenser, all are open systems, correct? So we have to apply the steady flow energy equation for each component. Okay, so now by comparing, assuming 1 kg of steam, so we can write the steady flow energy equation for each component. So first let us write for pump, boiler. Okay, energy coming into the boiler must be equal to energy going out to the boiler. So energy coming into the boiler is enthalpy of the water at state point 2, H2, and heat energy is coming in here, Q in, that is equals to enthalpy of the steam going out. That is what I wrote here. So here I am writing the steady flow energy equation by neglecting the kinetic energy and potential energy. So by this we can write Q1 is equal to H3 minus H2, right? Now similarly apply the Schrödinger energy equation for turbine. So now for turbine what happens? So energy coming in is H3, H3 is coming in, energy going out is H4 plus turbine work WT. So like this we can write. So from this what we can write? So turbine work is equal to H3 minus H4. Next we can apply the Schrödinger energy equation to the condenser. So energy coming into the condenser is H4, energy going out is H1 plus Q out, that we are also called as Q2. So from this we can write Q2 is equal to H4 minus H1. And similarly we can apply the Schrödinger energy equation to the pump. So energy coming in is H1 plus WP is equal to H2. So from this we can write, so pump work is equal to H2 minus H1. So now net work done from the cycle is positive work minus negative work, sum of all the work transfer, that is WT minus WP. That we can write H3 minus H4 minus H2 minus H1. So now we will derive the efficiency of the Rankine cycle. So any efficiency is equal to what? Net work output divided by heat supplied, correct? That we can write WT minus WP divided by Q1. This we can write like this, correct? Now the pump handles the liquid water which is incompressible generally, that is its density or specific volume undergoes little change with an increase of pressure, okay? For that purpose, so now for a reversible and adiabatic compression process that takes place in the pump, we can write by using the first law of thermodynamics. What we can write like this: TdS is equal to dH minus VdP. So basically this equation is derived from the first law of thermodynamics applied to a cycle process, that is dQ is equal to dU plus dW, correct? From that we derived. So dQ is equal to TdS for reversible adiabatic compression process, and dU plus differentiation of PV gives dH, because H is equal to U plus PV, minus VdP. So for reversible adiabatic process, it is basically isentropic process, dS is equal to 0 and dH becomes VdP. Since change in specific volume is very negligible, so we can write delta H is equal to V into delta P, or H2 minus H1 is equal to V1 into P2 minus P1. So usually the pump work is quite small compared to the turbine work, and sometimes it is going to neglect. So in that case we are going to assume H1 is same as H2. In that situation, so Rankine cycle efficiency becomes only H3 minus H4 divided by H3 minus H2. We are going to neglect the pump work. But same thing we cannot do in the Carnot vapor power cycle, where we cannot neglect the compression work. So compression work is more than the pump work. So now we will discuss regarding the performance parameters of the steam power plant. So there are two important performance parameters are there, along with the efficiency. Efficiency is also one of the performance parameter. Along with that, there are two performance parameters are there. One is steam rate and second one is work ratio. Steam rate means it is defined as the rate of steam flow, that means mass flow rate of steam required for producing unit shaft output, that means 1 kilowatt. Mathematically that we can write like this: steam rate is equal to, it is a ratio of mass of steam flow rate. So usually we are going to assume mass flow rate is 1 kg divided by net work done. So this unit becomes this much, okay? So this also we can call it as specific steam consumption, SSC. So that is usually tells with respect to per hour basis. So that becomes like this. So to convert this into per hour, we are going to multiply by 3600, okay? So this is the unit of SSC, specific steam consumption. So where network should be substituted in terms of kilowatts. And next, work ratio. Work ratio means already we discussed in the gas power cycle. it is the ratio of net work done divided by positive work, that means turbine work. Okay, so this is the work ratio. These are very important. One is specific steam consumption and second one is work ratio. And now we will discuss the last topic of today's video, that is comparison between the Rankine vapor power cycle and Carnot vapor power cycle. Okay, let us discuss the comparison between them. So first comparison is which cycle gives the more efficiency under what conditions. So those things we are going to discuss here. So between the same temperature limits, that means higher temperature and lower temperature limits, so Rankine cycle provides higher specific work output than the Carnot cycle, because area under the PV diagram is more in Rankine cycle than Carnot cycle whenever the same temperature limits is maintained in that situation. Consequently, Carnot cycle requires a smaller steam flow rate, resulting in smaller size of plant for a given power output. However, Rankine cycle calls higher rates of heat transfer in boiler and condenser. So this is mainly due to because of here in Rankine cycle we are going to use a pump. So pump occupies less volume and also it requires less power, whereas in Rankine cycle compressor occupies more volume as well as it requires more power. Second comparison, since Rankine cycle only part of heat supplied using isothermal process, that is evaporating portion under temperature T1, therefore its efficiency lower than that of Carnot cycle. But in Carnot cycle, entire amount of heat energy takes place through the isothermal process. The efficiency of Rankine cycle will approach that Carnot cycle more nearly if superheat temperature rise is reduced. So we are going to increase the temperature of dry steam in Rankine cycle. So that is especially where that we are going to do to get the quality of steam exit from the turbine must be high. For that purpose, we are going to superheat the steam. Okay. So if you not superheat much, then the same Rankine cycle approaches the Carnot cycle. And the last one, the advantage of using pump to feed liquid to the boiler instead of a compressor, that means compressing a wet vapor, is obvious that the work of compression is very large compared to the pump. As I told earlier, since we are using here pump, it requires less power, okay, to just lift the water, because water is incompressible. But compressor has to compress the vapor along with pressure rise, so it requires more power. So these are the comparisons of Rankine cycle and Carnot cycle. Hope you understand, and hope you understand better. And in the next class, we are going to deal with the what are the different losses of Rankine vapor power cycle. Actual vapor power cycle we are going to discuss. So hope you understand better. And if you have any doubts regarding this video, you can contact me. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Nandan.